Thank you, Mr. Speaker. So I think after this, we'll do a collection to buy the Honourable Biman Prasad a watch so that he knows how long 7 minutes is. And I think we've just had the opportunity of listening to somebody that emphatically stated in this House that he did not say that, and today he says he said it after all. I've heard that before. I've heard that before. Mr. Speaker, sir, this afternoon, I think I stand up here to support the budget that has been presented, the COVID response budget, and also the legislation that goes together with it. And I congratulate the Attorney General and the team that he has had at the Ministry of Economy for the hard work that they've put in to put into place the particular suggestions that we are discussing today. And I think I'd like it to make known that everybody had an opportunity to pass on their ideas to the Ministry of Economy team. You did. If any members of the House on that side or this side had any ideas, they had the freedom to pass on their idea. You had the freedom. You don't have to come and do it in Parliament. If you really feel for this country, you've got a particular idea, particular bits and pieces of information that you wanted to pass on to the minister, you could have freely have done it. There was no limitations to that. So there was an opportunity to pass on the ideas that we had to the Honourable Minister. The Minister for Responsible for the Economy has also talked to us about the scale of the disaster that faces us. The COVID program, it has the potential to be one of the biggest problems that we've ever faced. The impacts now are much more stronger than the crisis that the world faced back in 2008. And I was just looking at some of the stats that was this morning, looking at Italy, for instance. As we had stated yesterday, they had 5 cases at the beginning of the month, and 1 month later, at the end of the month, they had up to 60,000 cases. Today, they now have 80,000 cases. They have 80,000 cases and 800 deaths. So they are running at about 136 deaths for every million of population. If we translate the severity of that problem to Fiji, for Fiji, that would be an equivalent of around 120 deaths for Fiji. Fiji cannot afford 120 deaths from COVID-19. It is a worst-case scenario and something that we have to fight hard to make sure that we can address this. And how this needs to be addressed is to isolate, to control our borders as we are doing now, and also to contain the problems that we have. Where we have problems, we have to contain it, we have to identify, we have to isolate and treat to make sure that we have no mortality from this virus. And this is what we're aiming for. Where the virus is already in this country, we need to control it and contain it to make sure that it does not spread. And if we can do this well enough, we will not have to lock down this country. This is the approach that we have. Lock down the threat. Lock down the threat so we do not have to reach the stage that India has reached, Italy has reached, where they've had to lock down the country. We lock down the threat. That is why the curfews are being put in place. That's why the quarantine is being put in place. All of us in this Parliament have our part to play in making sure that we can get the rest of the population of this country to lock down the threat. That must be our focus. That is the focus of this government. That is also the focus of the budget that is being put before Parliament today. We must lock down the threat in our country. And I think I have to congratulate the work that has been done by the Minister for Health. I was quite taken aback at the statements that was done by the Honourable Nawai Kula, talking about the role of the Minister for Health, saying that he has not done anything. The people in that ministry have been working very hard. They've been working very long hours. Not just them, but all other agencies that are sitting there long hours, making sure the members of the military, members from my ministry, other ministries, working very hard to address this. And to say something like that in Parliament, with an absence of facts, not based on any factual information, I think it's ridiculous, and it's not something that we should be saying. Because right now, we in this House should be showing leadership to the rest of this country. We should be uttering things in this House that brings the country together so that together we can address this. As I will say later, one of the most important things that we can do is make sure that we can lock down the threat. How do we lock down the threat? We lock down the threat by making sure that everybody in this country follows the advisories that have been given by the Ministry of Health. We have to make people do that. If they don't do it, we will not be able to lock down the threat. That's why we're trying to reduce movement. Ships going out into the inter-island, we want to stop it. We want to make sure that people wash their hands. People keep the physical distancing. That People do not drink from the same billow. These are simple things that we need to do. All of us are leaders in various communities. We need to make sure that people take up this message. Yeah. This, if we can do this while there is no vaccine for this COVID-19 yet, by changing behavior of people in this country, and all of us can do this in this parliament, all of us. We can change the behavior so they themselves start following the advisories, and that will become the vaccine for us. That is the challenge for us. This is something that I call upon all the members of the House. What does that bell mean? 2 minutes left. 2 minutes left. Okay. So for my part, I would like also to thank all the agencies that have come on board to contribute to this to the approach that we have. Thank EFL for making it so that families that have less than $30,000 will not have to pay for the electricity. Thank Water Authority of Fiji for making sure that they'll be able to provide the water that people need to wash their hands. For the stimulus package and also for the new natural disaster rehabilitation facility that will be useful for the small businesses in this country. And then my last point, there's a story of an old man who was talking to his niece, who was a queen of a particular country, and he told that young niece of his, her name was Essa, that perhaps for such a time as this was she born, to be able to show leadership in the place that she was. And I think that's a message also for all of us in this House. We have to take this message. We have to get the people of this country to start following the advisories. If we do that, we will make sure that we will not go to level 3 and run out of ventilators and ICUs as they are facing now in Italy. I call upon all the members of this House, all the people of this country that are listening to me, follow the advisories. If we follow the advisories, we will not have to lock down Fiji. If we follow the advisories, we will save lives. This is very critical. And I appreciate all the work that is being done by the divisional commissioners all across Fiji. As I'm talking now, there are teams of civil servants going village by village, settlement by settlement, telling people to follow the advisory. That is something we must do. At the moment, these advisories are seeking in people's minds as knowledge that they have. That needs to be converted to something that they actually do. Fiji needs behavioral change. Everything that is in this budget will help us to achieve that and to also look after the things that will happen after COVID-19. So I look through to all of us in the House, members of the opposite side, whatever you say here, please say things that will encourage people to do the right thing. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, sir.